In this lecture, Rafael Lorenz will teach you about process mining.
Hey, today we're going to learn about process mining. You see what process mining is and how it can be used in different industries. First, let's see why we need process mining in the first place. In many firms, processes are standardized and designed. So they want to ensure that a certain process runs with the same steps all the time. Let's have a look at, for an example, a customer complaint. So the first step that would be is that a customer calls a firm and is answered. Then his call is forwarded to a technical person that is able to solve the case. Well, this might be the design process. However, in reality, those processes don't need to run exactly in that same order. For instance, the customer might be forwarded to the wrong technical person. Hence, the technical person needs to redirect the customer to another person. Second, it might be that there was a certain intended time how long it shall take for the company to solve the customer's issues. However, due to a certain complexity in his problem or to misunderstanding within the company, the process might take longer, so we have longer lead times than actually intended. In the worst case, the technical person is not able to solve the problem of the customer at all and is neither able to redirect to another technical person. So the customer needs to call the service tech again and is beginning at the first stage of the process. Of course, these deviations are not intended and are not designed by the company in the first place. So we see that the design process not often or not always matches the reality. In order to understand where these deviations from the design process happen, we need to create transparency. And here, process mining can help an organization to create transparency and to see how the real world differs from the intended process. In brief, process mining combines two different streams. On the one hand, process science with the components, for example, of operations management, business process management, or even operations research. On the other hand, we have data science, with its components of, for instance, statistics, data mining, or even machine learning. Process mining now bridges these two different streams in order to create this transparency that we have discussed before. To understand what it means, let's have a look at a very simple example. You see here the intended process steps of this manufacturing process. Of course, we expect the processes happen as we have designed it, and that the flow that each single order goes and runs through our manufacturing system in an intended way. This manufacturing process consists of two different lines in the beginning and an assembly process in the end. And the two different lines in the beginning, we produce the legs, and on the other line, we produce the top. Both of these lines consist of cutting, milling, and sanding the leg and the top in the lower line. After these two lines, we have a marriage of the two products where they are assembled together. In today's manufacturing, the flow of the products can be traced back through digitalization. For instance, each time a product enters or leaves a certain process, it is tracked by sensors, and this data is stored somewhere in the systems. In a very simple form, this data can be stored as an event log. The event log gives information about which product was produced when and where. Let's have a look at such an event log. We have on the first column the case ID. This is an identifier for a certain product. Then in the second column, we have the activity. The activity tells us which process was performed. Was it cutting, was it milling, or was it sanding? Then we have the third and the fourth column indicating a certain timestamp at which the product went into the process and after which when it went out of the process. In the next column, we can add, for instance, a resource on which machine was this product or this specific product produced. We can add costs, and we can add more columns as we wish if we have more attributes that are relevant for this certain process. So what we can see is that the event log actually tells us what happens in the real world. And what process mining now tries to do is to compare the real world as recorded in the event log with the designed world as designed in the process model.
Now let's have a look at this example in process mining. What we can see here is the processes that have actually happened. On the left-hand side, we see the manufacturing of the top, and on the right-hand side, we see the manufacturing of the legs. Down here at the assembly, those two parts are brought together and assembled together. What we can also see here are the different process times. And in fact, we can see the different median durations of them. So let's have a look at the left-hand side of producing the top part. We see cutting, which took a median 100 seconds. We can see milling taking 119 seconds. And we can see sanding having a median duration of 4.2 minutes. Through that, we can already spot some bottlenecks within our processes. In this case, having the longest process time, which is sanding of the top parts. Next to the process times, we can also see the time it took for the different parts to come from one process to the subsequent process. Those are the arrows in between the different processes. So we can see here, for instance, between cutting the legs and milling the legs, it took on median 7 hours. This is equal to the time queuing or inventory laying time between the different processes. Now what is interesting here is, for instance, that between milling and sanding, it took 18 hours. So it took 18 hours on median when a product left milling and started sanding. This again has to do with the bottleneck in sanding, which took the longest time. Besides the different times, we can also see the flow of the products. As we saw before, we intended the different products to flow from cutting, milling to sanding, both the top parts and the leg parts, and then coming together at assembly. However, what we see in reality is that some parts actually jump the queue from cutting to sanding, or for instance, went back from milling to cutting. The latter one can happen if we have some quality defects and we need some rework. The first one, which is jumping another process, can happen if, for instance, the part did not get to milling, so there was a quality issue, or it can also happen due to problems with sensors. That said, that the sensor did not track the parts that came from cutting to milling and sanding, and therefore we see a line here. Both of these reasons are need to be taken care of. So for instance, it needs to ensure that the products are tracked in the right manner, and maybe their sensors need to be adjusted. And in case there are some parts where milling was missing, we need to see whether they went to the final customer, and we need to analyze these products. And this can be also done through process mining. In that case, that we look into which parts actually jumped the queue. This can be done by clicking and then on filtering for this path. Now, this could let you discover the processes that we have just seen over a certain period of time. For that, click on animation. In this animation, we see all the processes that we have seen before, and we see the different products floating through this animation and through the processes with yellow dots. So we click on play and we'll see the process starting. We also reduce the time to slow so that we can see a little bit more what's going on here. What we see here again are the different products that flow through our manufacturing line. And even though it looks very cluttery, what we can take here away is that we see inventories between the different processes, especially for the legs, and between milling the top and milling and sanding the top. However, after sanding the top, parts are immediately transported and started in assembly. So this gives a certain a certain possibility to view the different price or time, and is especially important when bottlenecks are not static but are dynamic. That said, they change over time and shift from one station to another. This in reality is often the case because we don't have only static bottlenecks, but we do have bottlenecks that might change over time, and this animation actually helps process managers to see when and where bottlenecks are occurring and where they shift to. I hope this little example helped to understand what process mining can do in manufacturing. It basically creates transparency and helps to compare the real activities that happen on the shop floor with a process model that indicate the intended and desired behavior. For this example, we use software Disco. However, there are tons of other vendors out there that offer the possibility to do process mining. For instance, Celonis is being one of the biggest player in the market. But if you want to use Disco and try it out yourself, you can do so with an academic license that ETH is registered for.